Well, that's one movie down and one more to go, so let's move on to Interstellar, the latest film from Christopher Nolan. This movie takes place on a post-apocalyptic Earth of sorts, where the planet was not really destroyed by, you know, nuclear fallout, like it seems to be in every post-apocalyptic story, and it wasn't aliens either. Basically, it was some sort of blight that caused crops to wither and die all over the planet, and the end result is people just kind of died out of starvation because we didn't have enough food to feed them. And it's gotten to the point where the population of Earth is now into the millions. Yeah, 9 billion people reduced to just a few million. That's a scary thought, to be sure. And at this point, pretty much the only crop that they can still grow that hasn't been completely destroyed by the blight is corn. Although they still have beer for some reason. I'm not sure how they managed to pull that off, but I suppose it's not totally inconceivable that they could find a way to make beer out of corn. I guess I don't know how it would be done, but I'm sure someone would figure it out. But one way or another, if man wants beer, he will find a way to make beer. That's pretty much a constant in the universe. I think we can all agree with that. And also, it's very, very dusty. There's basically a never-ending dust bowl going on, much like we've seen in America's history. And the main character of this story is a guy named Cooper, who is a former pilot turned farmer, because farmers are the one thing the world needs right now, because that's the only way they can struggle to keep the remaining humans alive at this point. And he is recruited by NASA to fly a shuttle through a wormhole in space, which points to a distant galaxy that might possibly have a new home for them, because one way or another, humans are eventually going to run out of ways to plant crops, and then they're all going to die if they cannot find a new world. So that's Cooper's job, is to find them a new home, and if possible, find a way to migrate everyone from Earth to the new world, or if that's not possible, they have a plan B, which is basically take a bunch of these frozen embryos and use them to repopulate the new planet and keep the human race going. One of the major criticisms of this movie, and honestly it's one that I do have to agree with, because it is a major problem. The movie tries to present itself as being a hard science fiction story, when in reality it's really a science fantasy. And it tries to do kind of a little bit of both, because they did actually have a theoretical physicist as a consultant on this movie, a guy named Kip Thorne, and he worked with them on many things, including the design of the black hole that is at the center of this new galaxy that they're exploring. And from what I can tell, the design of the black hole is scientifically accurate, and there are a lot of things that this movie does get scientifically accurate. There are also a lot of things that it gets wrong, even some that Kip Thorne himself will agree with. Even as he watched the movie that he was a consultant on, there were a few moments that made him cringe. Like, for example, there's one planet they go to that has clouds made of ice, which should not be possible because the weight of the ice should bring that thing crashing down to the surface right away. There's also a bit of an issue with time becoming slower as you get closer to a strong gravity field like one that's associated with a black hole, which does actually happen, but the way it happens in this movie doesn't seem quite right. Because there's a scene after they go through the wormhole, the first planet they visit, they run some calculations and they determine that if they go down to the surface of the planet, 45 minutes on that planet will equate to 7 years of Earth time. Because that's how much time is slowing down for them on that planet. And yet when they get to the surface, they determine that the gravity is only 30% higher than that of Earth. So let me see if I understand this correctly. 30% higher gravity translates into an 8 million percent increase in time. Something, I freely admit I am not a theoretical physicist, but something about that does not sound right. Also, when they when Cooper visits the NASA base in the beginning of the movie, their shuttle launching pad is right next to the fucking conference room. Just separated by a simple concrete wall, and that's it. This is fucking James Bond Moonraker shit going on here. I mean, and don't get me wrong, I like Moonraker. It's stupid, but I like it. But I would never claim that that's hard science. And yet this movie is trying to be hard science when it suits the plot, but when it doesn't, it just kind of chucks it right out the window. And sometimes it's essential to get the plot moving. Other times, like with the clouds made of ice, it has no bearing on the plot, and it's just there to look cool. Which really makes me wonder, why did they even bother to try going hard science in the first place and instead just be pure science fantasy? Because you can do that. There's absolutely nothing wrong with that. I watched Doctor Who. Doctor Who is not a hard science show. At all. Oh God, no. But it's still perfectly entertaining as a science fiction property. You know, you can go that route. Or you can go the hard science route. That's fine. Either way, just pick one and stick with it. So, at least for me, that is where this movie really failed. Is because where it couldn't decide whether it wanted to be hard science or science fantasy. Fortunately, it succeeds pretty much everywhere else. Honestly, I can't find much else to complain about with this movie. That's really it. Everything else, especially the acting, which is outstanding across the board, especially McConaughey. And it still feels weird saying that. I mean, even after he won the Oscar last year, still, wow. Who would have thought that this guy would be doing all these great performances in recent years? And I would not at all be surprised if he got another Best Actor nomination out of this movie, because he absolutely killed it. Especially, there's one scene in particular where I mentioned this, that planet where they have 45 minutes on the surface translates into 7 hours back home. They end up spending far more time down there than they planned on because of an incident. And when they finally get back, like 20 some years have already passed. And they've been receiving messages from home. And because of the gravitational pull of the black hole, they can't send anything back. And so all McConaughey can do is just watch these messages that have been coming in and archived, and basically is watching his kids grow up in front of him before his very eyes. And all he can do is sit there and watch and has no way to actually get in touch with them or talk to them at all. And throughout that entire scene, he doesn't say one word. It's all just pure facial expression and nothing else, and he just absolutely owns it. It's fucking amazing, it really was, and a very emotional scene. And the movie does pay homage to several previous science fiction works without outright stealing from them, which is nice to see. There's like when they go through the wormhole, they're definitely pulling a bit of 2001 from that. There's even a bit of Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy in here, because they're the expedition shuttles that they have here all come with their own artificial intelligence robots, who definitely sounds like some of the you know, your plastic pal who's fun to be with from Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, with their programmable personalities. They can actually set various parameters like honesty level. We'll put it at 90%, because 100% honesty isn't always the best thing. Sometimes you gotta be a little dishonest. Humor, let's set it at 70%. Self-destruct sequence engaged in 10 seconds. Let's bump it down to 60. That's a bit too much. You know, stuff like that. It's, yeah, I really did like the robots in this. They are just as good of characters as the humans, honestly. They're a lot of fun. Visually, holy shit, this was so well done, and I kind of regret not seeing this one in IMAX. I think if I had known it was going to look this good, I would have gladly paid the extra money, because this would have looked absolutely amazing. Even on the screen I saw it on, it still looked amazing. You know, there's, of course, a little bit of computer animation here and there, but it's all done very well, and they definitely tried to keep everything practical whenever possible. There's very little green screen work at all in here. It's all very organic and feels very real, and it's just amazing job by Nolan on that end. And the ending, without going into spoilers, mind fucking a half. Really, it was. Wow, it's also gets in the point where they're defying the laws of physics a bit, I think, here. But honestly, at that point, I had let it go by that point. I was just kind of along for the ride. And it was, yeah, it was a very interesting way to end the movie. I kind of like what they did there, although it was really fucking weird. So in the end, while this movie does have a few pitfalls here and there, I do think the positives definitely outweighed the negatives, and I did enjoy this movie. I don't think I enjoyed it quite as much as Big Hero 6, and in fact, if you're torn between those two movies, I would definitely have to lean towards Disney on this one. Sorry, Chris, but I think Disney has your beat this time. But still, they're both very good movies. I don't know if I would say this is Nolan's best work. I think I would still put Inception above this one, but it's still a very solid effort from him for sure, and will probably be up for several awards when the Oscar season comes around. And I definitely would recommend seeing it. If you are going to see it, you should see it on the big screen, because this is just one of those movies that has to be seen on the big screen. And in fact, if you are willing to plunk down the extra money for IMAX, I think that is probably the way to go. And you know, like I said, I kind of wish I had done that myself, because it does really look that good, even on the not as big as IMAX screen. I'd say definitely don't wait for rental if you have any interest in seeing this movie at all. Just see it on the big screen while you can. And I guess that's about all I have to say about Interstellar. So, till next time, take care.
You might have to decide between seeing your children again and the future of the human race.
We'll find a way. We always have.